Does employment provide social and psychological benefits beyond its role as a source of income? This is a long-standing idea in social science, but providing evidence for it is challenging. The employed and unemployed differ in ways that are likely correlated with well-being, and because income earned from employment may itself have psychological value, it is difficult to isolate non-pecuniary effects. This paper tackles these challenges and provides a causal estimate of the psychosocial value of employment among the Rohingya refugees of Myanmar. In 2017, approximately 780,000 Rohingya fled a campaign of ethnic cleansing and crossed to Bangladesh to settle what is presently the largest refugee camp in the world. Because refugees are not legally allowed to work, employment opportunities in the camp are scarce. Among this study's sample of working-age individuals, only 11% report having worked in the previous month. On average, 8 hours of their waking day is spent in leisure activities, and the baseline data hint at the potential consequences. Individuals who report having been unemployed for the entirety of the previous month are 14 percentage points more likely to qualify as depressed. But does this reflect a causal relationship? To answer this, the authors conducted a randomized controlled trial in which 745 camp residents were randomly assigned to one of three groups. In the first group, residents were offered employment in the form of a surveying task aimed at collecting data to improve camp services. Workers were asked to walk through their blocks 4 times a day, tallying the activities their neighbors were engaged in. This consumed approximately 2.5 hours per workday and an average of 3 days per week for 2 months. In the second group, residents were not offered any work, but received a large fee for weekly survey participation. These fees were equivalent in size to the wages paid in the employment group, and were enough to at least double potential weekly consumption. Finally, the control group received no work and only a small fee for weekly survey participation. This design allows the authors to estimate the total psychosocial value of employment, and to also isolate the non-pecuniary value of employment. Their primary outcome of interest is an index of psychosocial well-being, comprised of 7 mental and social health measures. And they find that employment generates significant psychosocial benefits. Relative to the control group, those in the employment group experience a meaningful increase in the psychosocial index and in each of its subcomponents. They show a reduction in depression, anxiety, or frustration, and exhibit greater life satisfaction, possess higher self-worth, and feel greater control over their lives. As a benchmark for these effects, a year-long psychoeducation program in the Rohingya camps led to a 0.15 standard deviation reduction in depression. This paper's 2-month employment intervention led to a 0.24 standard deviation reduction. The benefits of employment also extend beyond the psychosocial. The employed are less likely to feel physically ill, and they perform better on memory and math tests and are less risk-averse. Even more striking, comparing the employment and cash groups reveals that the benefits of employment are largely driven by non-pecuniary factors. Across nearly all measures, the employed have better outcomes than those receiving cash, and the differences are substantial. Employment improves mental health at a magnitude 4 times greater than cash alone. Importantly, individuals appear to perceive and internalize these benefits. At the end of the 2-month intervention, the employment group was offered a surprise additional week of work, and their reservation wage was elicited. 69% were willing to work an additional week for zero pay, and among this group, the vast majority preferred working for free over an alternative low-effort paid activity. What aspect of employment drives these psychosocial effects? There are several potential mechanisms, as employment shapes individuals in myriad ways. It can affect how they perceive themselves, how they structure their day, and how they spend their earnings. The authors explore each of these channels, and in this setting, they find strong evidence for the impact of employment on self-worth. Employment appears to improve individuals' perceptions of how valuable they are to their family, while receiving cash alone worsens them. And so, this paper provides evidence that employment generates substantial non-pecuniary psychosocial benefits. These results should be interpreted through the lens of this particular context, but several points are worth noting. First, the Rohingya community's constrained labor market opportunities, material poverty, and limited leisure activities are all features common to other settings. As such, this evidence may be informative for the psychosocial value of employment among other large populations. For example, the incarcerated, the unemployed in low-income countries, and much of the world's agricultural poor. More directly, these findings are highly relevant for the population of forcibly displaced persons, which reached a historic high of 80 million in 2020. The majority of refugees reside in countries with legal barriers to work, and mental health is a persistent challenge in these communities. This paper provides a prototype for a scalable form of employment that may significantly improve well-being. To read more on this topic, you can check out the paper's references to other related work. This includes research on the psychosocial value of employment, the mental health impact of cash transfers, and a growing set of papers engaged with refugee populations.